now coming back to the environment variables, variables are dynamically named values that can be used to make your CI/CD pipelines completely parameterized. In general, it's always the best practice to keep your to actually remove your hard-coded values and use environment variables to make the jobs portable and provide agnostic. So if you're hard-coding something there, so it will actually make your code very brittle. So someday, if you want to move out this pipeline from one provider to another, you'll have to like redo it without, and it won't be possible without modifying the code. So specifically, GitLab has a huge list of predefined variables that can aid to build robust and flexible CI/CD pipelines. And this link can be used to view the list of available predefined values. The most commonly used and important ones actually comprise of commit reference name, commit branch, commit tag, and external pull request IDs. So these variables allow you to shape your pipelines according to different Git branches. And in my opinion, this provides a great flexibility in differentiating jobs based on the environments. So let me just go and share this link. So as you can see, this whole list of environment variables that you can use while developing your pipelines. And I was mentioning about this particular environment variable that is very useful. So you can use this environment variable to run different kind of logic for different branches. So if you're following Git structured development, so what this means for you is that depending on the branch name, for example, master or state, you can run different sets of jobs. And it's very easy to configure that using this environment variable. So had it been hard-coded into the pipeline, next time anybody would change the branch, it would be having very difficult for you to change the code again and again. So it's always easy to use environment variables instead of hard-coded values over there. It's coming back to the cache dependencies. So every CI/CD job requires some kind of building phase where the test target is built using third-party dependencies. And depending on your technology stack, these dependencies are fetched using plugin managers, modules, importers, et cetera. So for example, you are using Node. This would mean that you are fetching all the third-party modules using Node, NPM or YARN. And then similarly in the Python world, you might be using requirements or TXT to use pip to fetch all the dependencies. The common pain point in building with third-party modules across the languages is that it takes a lot of time to fetch dependencies and compile them. And now imagine doing this process over 100 times a day for multiple projects and calculate the time and resources wastage it incurs. So if there was a way to cache these build dependencies and use this cache dependencies for many pipelines, it would make CI build much, much faster and it would reduce the bandwidth wastage. And ultimately, it will unclog the CI pipeline so that same infra can be used for much more builds. So GitLab's cache dependencies allow you to do exactly this straight out of GitLab YAML file. And it's as simple as setting a cache directory in YAML file and the key attribute. So just ensure to use the same name of the key in all the jobs where cache directory is used. So I would definitely show you the how I am caching dependencies. So in my jobs, what I'll do is that I will just fetch the dependencies once and I'll not rebuild or fetch dependencies as long as my dependency manifest file doesn't change. So in case of Node.js, if your package JSON is not changing or if the package log.js is not changing, you can be pretty sure that the previous requirements can be still used. So the idea is that you cache these Node modules once, store them somewhere, and in the future jobs, when you feel that the package JSON has not changed, you can still fetch those dependencies. So it's always faster to download some resource from the internet and unzip it rather than like building it from the scratch. And the Node.js developers should know the feeling like how it takes a lot of time to fetch all the dependencies that build them on every commit. So now the common practice to ensure cache between branches is to use Git-based environment and use variables such as cache key. So a cache key ensure that that you are fetching the right file for the job. So for example, if you set a cache key by your commit branch name, so all the jobs that will run for the same branch will use the same cache. And that way you can be pretty much sure that you don't need to fetch all those dependencies again. Now, the most important point while using cache dependencies is that you should actually invalidate the cache when you're not using them. And GitLab provides you powerful primitives to invalidate cache. And this can be done either via UI or by clearing the cache key. So there's a limit till which you can cache files in the GitLab for free plans. And I would suggest you that you should be deleting the caches after some period of time to keep the buffer for your future jobs. And an extension point here would be like, you can optionally fetch dependencies and build them only when the package manifest file changes. And this is very superior to using cache always. So as I've already mentioned, only fetching Node.js dependencies whenever the package JSON changes. So now coming back to triggers, like how can you trigger the CI/CD pipelines? So the easiest way to trigger CI/CD is by performing any Git-based operation, such as pushing in a branch, merging a pull request, or creating a tag for which handlers are mentioned in the GitLab YAML file. So this is the most frequently used and the most convenient method to trigger your CI/CD. So if you have your repositories in GitLab and you have a GitLab CI file, so you can define that a particular job should run on pushes. Some jobs should run on the merge request pulls and other ones only when a special operation is performed, such as creating a tag, git tag. The second option that you can use to trigger your CI/CD jobs are webhooks. So webhooks provide a very convenient method to trigger CI/CD on demand by making an HTTP post call to specialized URLs. This is very useful for event-based triggering, where webhook can be called whenever the required event occurs. For example, you can set up a cron to run your nightly builds on GitLab by just hitting the curl request on webhook URL at the desired interval. And like any other event can also be used as long webhook can be hit in some response. So you can configure any kind of event on your end, and the only job you have to do is like hit the specialized URL and your GitLab pipeline will run in that response. So GitLab has a provision for the manual intervention by authorized users as well. So in the GitLab YAML file, you can mention a part of your pipeline to run only after somebody with the access in your team can resume the job from the UI. So this feature enables constructing continuous delivery pipelines that we have already discussed. And everything except deployment can be automated, and only after the manual intervention, the deployment can take place. So I'll show you how to do this in the practice in the demo. So last point before we move to the demo is there are like two special keywords that allow you to add any amount of flexibility in your GitLab pipelines, GitLab CI/CD pipelines per se. And this feature is only limited to GitLab, but this is only at the syntax level. Other providers also provide such kind of flexibilities via some other variables. But specifically for the GitLab, only in except are your two things that you should always use to configure the pipelines. So these constructs are the nut and screw that GitLab CI/CD pipeline and that allow customization. So only defines the name of the branches and tags for which the job will run. And for example, except defines the name of the branches and tags for which the job will not run. So you can add any kind of condition in which your job should run. So most importantly, you need to keep some rules in mind that only and except are inclusive. So if both only and except are defined in the job specification, then the ref is filtered by only, nothing else. So then only and except allow use of regular expressions. This is really interesting feature and make any kind of customization possible by playing over the strings. So for example, you want to run a job for the branches which start by name release, or maybe start by the name of test. So this is a very powerful feature that you can do here very easily by using only and except. And only and except allow you to specify repository paths to filter jobs for forks as well. So if somebody has forked a GitLab repository, so you can limit only and except to allow that job only to run when some change has been pushed to your original repository rather than the forked one. So some of the interesting values that can be applied over only and except are the branch names, tags, and this special keyword called merge requests. So if you apply a condition with only of merge requests, so that pipeline will only run whenever somebody raises a merge request. So you can also use multiple keys under only and except, and these keys will be evaluated as a single co-joined expression. And so that is only means that include this job if all of the conditions match, and accept would mean that exclude this job if any of the conditions match, with only individual keys are logically joined by AND. So if you use the only parameter and specify multiple conditions, so these conditions will be translated into a Boolean operation where all the conditions will be necessary in order to proceed there. So even if one condition fails, that pipeline won't run. And this also means that this relationship could be described very easily as using your Boolean operators. And then huge list of attributes that you can use with only and except. So you can actually go there on the link and see what all variables are available there. So yes, here's the advanced sections. As I mentioned, that the rest variables, changes, and the Kubernetes, these four keys are available by default. And you can use any other values under these keywords to make your pipelines as flexible as you want.